from Billy Collins, who has been a U.S. Poet Laureate a while back. And for those of you who might teach English or enjoy poetry, I think you'll appreciate this. I asked them to take a poem and hold it up to the light like a color slide, or press an ear against its hide. I say drop a mouse into a poem and watch him probe his way out, or walk inside the poem's room and feel the walls for a light switch. I want them to water ski across the surface of the poem, waving at the author's name on the shore. But all they want to do is tie the poem to a chair with a rope and torture a confession out of it. They begin beating it with a hose to find out what it really means. Lots of times I think we treat poetry and scripture maybe the same way. We kind of want to beat it to death to find that special meaning or to change the language somehow so that we can understand it better. And yet our scripture is filled with amazing imagery. The words in both scripture and also in our Catholic liturgies, the opening prayers, the Eucharistic prayer, our music, all of it has such amazing, amazing words to help us understand more fully what it is to be people of faith. You probably saw many churches this last week advertising Christmas Eve services all day tomorrow. So that means that they're not celebrating that fourth Sunday of Advent. And I'm really glad that we are and love the season of Advent. I'm actually sad that we're missing out on a whole week, because the messages of the Advent readings are amazing. Unlike any time of year, they give us amazing things to ponder. And the world out there, 2 months ago, started celebrating Christmas, and we know that it'll end on December 26th. And yet all of us here will start celebrating Christmas tomorrow night, and we'll go to the second weekend in January, the baptism of the Lord. Those words during Advent lead us to action. If we really listen to the readings that we've had, imagine what could happen. The lion and the lamb will lie down together. The darkness will not be overcome. The light will not be overcome by the darkness. Swords will be beaten into plowshares. Angels will sing in the sky, and of course, the climax of a little child leading us all. These all seem impossible, and yet there they are. The yes of Advent. Speaking of impossible and slightly confusing, in the Gospel today for the fourth Sunday, we'll hear the angel Gabriel coming to Mary and telling her what her future will hold. We call it the Annunciation, which means announcement. Another poet recently wrote a poem about the Annunciation and said, God waited for Mary's yes. The poet says, this was the moment no one speaks of, when she could still refuse. A breath unbreathed, spirit suspended, waiting. How often do we wait on God to figure out things for us? And yet God also waits on us. Mary could have refused, but she did not. And so we find ourselves seated here tonight. The yes of Advent. So much of our faith is about a mystery with a capital M. It's not something to be solved, but something to live into, to experience. And of course, the greatest mystery of our faith is the resurrection. And if we look at our scriptures from creation all the way through resurrection and the beginnings of the church, it's an award-winning drama with incredible actors, settings, and plots. You know, we saw the lines for the latest Star Wars movie extending around movie theaters. Wouldn't it be amazing if we had people lined up outside churches to come in to listen to this drama that unfolds every single day? Or maybe these stories have become kind of boring for us. As a kid, I remember thinking, why do we read the same old stories every week? Blah, 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 right? Why can't we mix it up a bit? And yet, as an adult, I really appreciate hearing those stories again and again, because I'm an place. We grow up, we have different experiences, so the Good Samaritan story catches me differently today than it did 10 years ago. We continue to ponder. I heard on a radio program recently that people like certainty better than hope. That makes me really sad. I wonder if because our culture is so about certainty, that the stories of mystery and the unknown we hear at church are confusing and perhaps maybe misunderstood. And yet, what a great antidote to our culture to have these stories. And what a great sign of hope Mary is for us all. She didn't know what she was signing up for. How often do we not know what we're signing up for? New parents, you get this one very well. Our first reading tonight also gives an indication of the incredible nature of who God is. King David wants to build a special place for God to dwell. The Ark of the Covenant was traveling through the desert covered by a tent, and David, he thinks God deserves more. And David, he's, you know, living in lavishness himself. And God, I love God's response. God kind of says, really? I think I've taken care of things pretty well since day one. Trust me, I am bigger than any place you can offer. What a great message for us to hear as we seek to kind of have that control on our daily lives. So I invite you to listen to the stories of healing and hope and joy in new ways as we approach Christmas and go through the Christmas season. They have much to teach us and help us to respond as Mary did, with trust and confidence and courage. What will our new yes be for the new year? In our world right now, that seems dark and chaotic and full of fear, I offer the final stanza of a poem by the beloved author Madeline L'Engle. It's called Into the Darkest Hour. And in a time like this, how celebrate this birth when all things fall apart? Ah, wonderful it is. With no room on earth, the stable is our heart. What will be the yes of your stable heart this Christmas season?
Many times it seems like we are waiting for God. That we're saying, come on, I want this. It's almost like we make God be like Santa Claus, saying, I'm waiting for Santa, I'm waiting for God. But I like what Molly talked about in her reflection. In that poem that she used, perhaps God is waiting for you. The poem was God is waiting for Mary to say her yes. Maybe God is waiting for you to say yes to something. So here's what we're going to do. For the homily time, I just want to take some quiet time. In the midst of all the Christmas craziness and preparations, just close your eyes. Close your eyes to do it. And just think, what is God calling you to say yes to? At work? At school? Among your family? Among your friends? What is God waiting for you to step up to say yes? Mary was open to saying, okay, God, may your will be done in me. May we do the same.